presentation about it. It's perfectly English in every sense and highly desirable. It's built to fit the client, and yet it's built to last for generations.
Of course, it is not by any means all 12-bore shotguns. There is, and there always has been, a very wide range of sizes and types of both guns and rifles. Most impressive of all were the massive rifles made for elephant shooting. In spite of their great weight, the recoil is substantial. Double rifles such as this, and this is a .577 3-inch Nitro Express by Army and Navy London, were much preferred to magazine arms, as the second barrel was instantly available. Hunting rifles are still occasionally made, though usually in smaller calibers. As with shotguns, they are individually constructed by hand, and together comprise the main achievement of the traditional English gunmaker. The choice of wood for the stock is one of the earliest decisions a prospective customer has to make. Nothing but the best walnut is used. Choice is as much for its beauty as its strength.
How about that? That's French again.
This is also French. Yes, that's quite a nice piece of wood.
Very nice. But
some more here. I think this is more what you're looking for.
Once selected, it is here in this workshop that the craftsman will shape the rough blank into a stock which really fits the customer, which gives the handmade gun its individuality as much a part of the owner as a handmade suit or pair of shoes. The first task is to transfer to the blank the guidelines of the precise measurements of cast-off, bend and length. In fact, its owner's exact measurements and personal idiosyncrasies. Once these are implanted on the wood, its exact shape is a foregone conclusion, since each piece of wood is not used until it is fully seasoned and incapable of warping. It is even possible to produce a gun with a stock so shaped that a man could fire from his right shoulder with his left eye, in effect a cross-eyed gun, which would be absolutely accurate. As he chisels, the craftsman hopes this valuable wood is without any internal flaws. If it has, he may have to start all over again. Losing excess metal is less troublesome than losing excess wood. Cutting the action of the gun from a rough casting is one area where machine work speeds the process with no loss of quality. This would once have been done by laborious filing. But the result will still be a finely polished blank ready for a great deal more individual attention. Only here is there a necessary break in tradition. Barrels, too, start under the same roof as rough blanks. This is, in fact, the only English gun-making establishment where this is still the case, though in the 19th century, barrel makers, like gunsmiths, could be counted in their dozens. These are, of course, steel barrels cut from solid metal. No one now survives who could make the fine Damascus barrel twisted from individual strands of metal. Nonetheless, the achievement of a fine shotgun or rifle depends upon the same constant check in cutting the barrel, which would be just as familiar to a gunmaker of yesterday. Though cut and checked by machine, the critical straightness of the barrel is still sighted or straightened by hand and eye, an eye practiced in seeing what to others would be totally imperceptible. A double gun is in effect two single barrel shotguns, and joining them so that they shoot together is one of the areas where the gunsmith's skill is at its highest. After this operation, both barrels should permanently behave as one, and as an irrevocable operation, it is essential that the barrel maker is personally satisfied with that alignment. Though a 19th century writer held the view, it is very doubtful if any two gunsmiths will agree as to the inclination of a pair of barrels. Thereafter, time and a slow furnace to avoid hardening the metal complete the job of brazing the barrels together. By making use of this process, a damaged barrel can always be replaced or renewed at a later date. The apparent effect to a complete layman of being made of a single piece given by a double shotgun or rifle stems from the fixing of two ribs between the barrels by a process known as tinning, for obvious reasons. The same 19th century Smith adjured that the space between the top rib and the barrels must be completely filled with solder, or rust will form there, with serious consequences. But it is the internal attention to a shotgun barrel which surely determines its effectiveness and distinguishes a hand-finished gun. The fine boring out, or lapping by hand, of the exactly correct internal dimension to produce the bore of the gun, and from which it takes its name, 12-bore, 8-bore, or whatever size of bore the customer requires or possesses the strength to handle. A 12-bore, now standardized as 0.729 inches, means simply the diameter of a pure lead ball weighing 1/12 of a pound. Nor is the barrel a simple cylinder. It possesses a chamber at the breech for the correct length of cartridge, and usually a constriction at the muzzle, only thousandths of an inch smaller than the internal diameter of the barrel, known as the choke, which concentrates the shot together before leaving the muzzle. Any mistake at this stage would undo all the hours of careful and exacting work already done. It is on the range that the real test comes. Here, at 40 yards, the gun is fired, and a given percentage of pellets have to strike inside a 30-inch circle. With a given cartridge, an unproved barrel has to put 50% of its 234 pellets inside the circle. A fully choked barrel must achieve 70%. And of course, the distribution of the shot must be reasonably even. Gaps in the pattern through which a bird might fly won't do. Gun making is essentially a team affair, as closely fitting as the parts of the gun itself. The total fit of the barrels to the action body and the stock to the action is critical, and there is no possibility of replacing material accidentally removed. The use of the smoke lamp is one of the traditional means of ensuring this does not happen, but the technique requires patience, dedication, and practice. To a surprising extent, the action body still owes its final exterior appearance to the artistic and aesthetic eye of the gunmaker. In this sense, little has changed in the last 400 years. Chiseling is still the vital technique. One reason why the individually created side-lock gun is so expensive is the large amount of precise handwork, the use of file and lamps, the checking and rechecking required in fitting the locks. Cheaper guns use box locks, where the mechanism is contained within the narrower confines of the action body itself. By the time the gunmaker reaches the chiseling of the exterior forms of the breech of the gun, it is hard to believe that the chisel is cutting steel and that these are actually separate pieces of metal. Such is the facility of the workmanship. But there are still the locks themselves to fit to the carefully finished lock plate. All these separate hand-finished and mirror-polished components must now be accommodated in the walnut stock, wholly shrouded by an elegant facade of blued and engraved steel and surrounded by polished wood. An invisible and unique feature of English gun-making. At this point, the skills and techniques of woodworker and metalworker combine to join lock to stock. The art is in not removing the slightest bit more wood than is necessary at this, the most slender and vulnerable section of the stock, and thereby weakening it, whilst at the same time ensuring that enough clearance is given to the moving parts so that they do not bind with the woodwork when the lock is operated. Unlike the continuing elegance of lock decoration, checkering the stock so the hands do not slip is the last remnant of the earlier vogue for carving the stock decoratively. It is also the last and most delicate stage of the stockmaker's work, which has quietly paralleled the work on lock and barrel. The finishing of the stock has been as much a work of patience and application as of anything else. The secret is a combination of oiling the wood with linseed oil, sanding, pumicing and re-oiling every day, day after day, for upwards of a month, often more, until not only a unique finish and colour is attained, but the very practical preservation of the wood is also ensured by the usual combination of the gunmaker's rare sense of art and practicality. Yet it is in the engraving that the final distinct personality of the client and the gunmaker come together and can be achieved only by the artistic flair and individual cutting skill and imagination of the artist. Within the rigid confines of the gun's components, every conceivable flight of fancy and of fashion has been encompassed. It is a strange tradition that the engraver is the only craftsman of all those combined skills and talents working to create the complete gun who is permitted to sign his work, although the whole gun bears a distinctive house style. But in justification, it is the engraver who has to be ready to depict anything that is required and who practices what must be one of the rarest art forms in the world. Behind this austere facade lies a thoroughly efficient, complex, and perfectly finished mechanism. The culmination of the work of many individual craftsmen and of months and sometimes years of patient application. In spite of long apprenticeships, in spite of apparent competition from factory-produced arms, in spite of the rarity and cost of materials, the best English gun lives true to its name and suffers no shortage of customers. There are even customers who will compete to pay £26,500 for a double-barreled 600 Nitro Express elephant rifle. This most royal of arms is a recent product of an English company worthy of the 500 years old tradition of fine gun making. Woe betide him who forgets to wear gloves while handling it.